exiting the European Union appears to have cleaved society from north to south. The individual component nations of Great Britain are hurtling into their own independent roots, as well they might. And it's in some ways it's great that it's going to be very hard for British officials to lecture any African country on the stability or otherwise of their regimes. When it comes to the Africa policy of the UK, will we see any movement soon?
Well, I think the current mayhem in the British political system has really set the country back on every conceivable level. But the one you're asking about, foreign policy, there's no question about that. I mean, foreign policy for the last 2.5 years, since the ill-fated 2016 referendum result, narrowly favouring an exit from the EU on no particular terms, with no particular mandate. Since that result, British foreign policy, the British Foreign Commonwealth Office, has been absolutely obsessed with Brexit. Some of the most talented diplomats, some just walked out after the result, but those that stayed in the system have been marshalled in to work on the Brexit project because it's deemed to be the most important issue in British politics, British foreign policy for 50 years, which it is. There's no question about that. So it must be heartbreaking for them to have done this for 2.5 years, just as heartbreaking as it is for the officials at the European Union to have been in negotiations for 2.5 years on a deal that the person who negotiated it, led the negotiations, Prime Minister Theresa May, cannot sell to her own party, her own political party, let alone the wider parliament, let alone the British people. We now don't know what the British people want. We have had several opinion polls which indicate a pretty insignificant move to actually stay in the European Union, but that hasn't been justified in the form of another vote, and we don't know whether we'll get the so-called people's vote, a second referendum. So we're in this sort of no person's land where Theresa May is still trying to sell the deal she cut with the European Union. It's been defeated twice in Parliament, and now the British government is applying to the European Union to say we will not make the deadline of leaving the European Union with an agreed deal by the 29th of March. So we have to have an extension, whether it's a long extension or a short extension, we don't know. But we have to have one because we can't get a majority in our parliament to do the deal. So that's had a terrible effect. And you're seeing it in all sorts of ways. There is a lack of high-level diplomatic representation across the world, British representation. They've got an ambassador in the US and so on. But right across Africa, there are empty posts. There's a lack of engagement in some of the key countries in Africa. Britain has had nothing to say, for example, about the events in Algeria. They've had Nigerian elections. It's had very little to say about Nigerian elections. You've got very important elections coming up in South Africa. We've heard some mutterings about British business possibilities in South Africa. You've got this massive climate change conference in Nairobi going on this week. No high-level British representation there. So you're really seeing a vacuum at the heart of British policy. The last bit in that jigsaw is Zimbabwe, where the Brits previously had been leading the negotiations with the Mnangagwa government, trying to put together some sort of financing package. They've seemed to have pulled back from taking the lead on that and handed over to Emmanuel Macron and the French government. So that's why the beginning of the week, Africa Report carried a story on the visit by Mthuli Ncube, the Zimbabwean finance minister, who came to Paris to talk not just to the French Treasury officials, but to the Paris Club and to commercial bankers in his efforts to raise about $2.2 billion dollars in a bridging loan that would enable him to pay back the international financial institutions, settle the arrears, and then get back on some sort of IMF program to relieve the dreadful economic crisis. So what you've got there is a pretty concrete example of Britain being absent in Zimbabwe, absent in Kenya, absent in Nigeria, absent in South Africa. And I think that can be quite fairly put at the door of the Brexit campaign. The Brexit has just taken that focus away.
It was very interesting to see last summer when you had a whole dance party of European leaders, on various dance floors across the continent. But the one who seemed to be actually, you know, passing muster, although his dancing was terrible, was President Macron. Mm. I was in the shrine in Lagos, the new shrine, as the aficionados will tell you, not the old shrine, it's the new one.
Still with old marijuana.
Nevertheless, the old vibe was very much present. And, you know, it was quite astonishing to see a world leader, you know, certainly President Buhari has not stepped foot inside the shrine, but to see, you know, President Macron visit this nightclub, and then, you know, bring Nigerian political and especially economic elites to Paris in February this year, it's a clear wooing of Nigeria by the French. The French national oil company Total was the only big major oil player in the last 5-6 years to have reached a final investment decision on a major project. They now have a huge platform which is responsible for 10% of the oil being pumped in Nigeria, the Egina project. And that relationship is clearly ongoing. They've signed big deals in Ethiopia, in Kenya today, new deals being signed with Vinci. So there is, you know, there is a clear intent there from France. And I guess we've talked about this a lot, but we are in this new phase of Gideon Rachman might call Easternization, you know, the center of gravity, you know, the geoeconomic center of gravity is being pulled east. And, you know, the continent is no longer, you know, the chasse gardée, as the French would call it, the hunting grounds of European companies. And although Macron, it doesn't take much prompting for him to fill a vacuum. He likes to be portrayed as the leader of Europe. But nevertheless, there's some joined up commercial policy there. I think he did some populist China bashing when he was in Djibouti. But France is not immune from its own Achilles heel. You know, it may like to portray a leadership role. You know, the Italians recently tried to puncture Macron's pomp by talking about the linking of the franc CFA, the CFA franc to the euro, which I think was probably smoke more than anything else from the Italian side. Mm-hmm. But what we have seen in Algeria is very interesting, and France seems to be staying relatively on the sidelines of that particular uprising.
Yeah, I think, and very wisely too, because of the poisonous history between the two countries, the brutality of the liberation war and the French response in the 1950s is still resonant in the minds of a generation of Algerians, and that generation is still very much into the political ascendancy in terms of their domination of the Front Libération Nationale, the ruling party in Algeria. And what's happened is really curious, is that party, it still has a kind of political resonance, but it's lost authority because its leader, President Abdelaziz Bouteflika, is seen as a kind of political roof cover for a group of business and security interests headed by his own brother, Saad Bouteflika. And I think it's really remarkable what the Algerians have done in the last month, less than a month, in fact, they've gone on the streets in their numbers. And some people said over 1 million people got on the streets a week ago in Algiers to demand that Bouteflika didn't submit his registration to stand in the presidential elections. They've done it pretty much 100% peacefully. They certainly haven't started any trouble. I think there's been a few fisticuffs and so on, but I don't think they certainly, there'd be no allegations that protesters are meeting out violence on anyone, security forces, everyone else. In fact, the vibes have been extremely good. You know, some protesters were giving flowers to the soldiers and stuff like that. So there was a sense of, you know, Tahrir Square sort of rerun almost in the early positive days of Tahrir Square and the Egyptian Revolution in 2011. So I think that's great. And it's had a result. It's had a result in the sense that Bouteflika has said he's not going to stand. They're delaying the elections now, sine die. So that's his own problem, because we don't know when the new elections are going to be held. Yesterday, he appointed a new technocratic prime minister who says he's going to recruit young Algerians to run the government. It's going to be emphasis is on fixing the economy and doing things, structural reforms, before the elections, and there won't be a long delay before the elections. I think that is the issue, the big issue coming up. What is the nature of this delay? What are the nature of these reforms that are going to be implemented and these constitutional changes? How quickly is it all going to happen? Because right now, my last point would be, the demonstrators aren't getting off the streets. They're still on the streets. They're demanding now more details and more participation.
A very, very free press in Algeria. Not everyone knows that, but the press in Algeria is absolutely terrific. El Watan, very popular daily newspaper. The headline was La Ruse. This is just a trick. Bouteflika is just doing it to blow smoke in people's faces. And actually, the same old pouvoir will not be letting go without a fight. Any sense of how that, you know, is being taken within the sort of the uprising movement? To what extent are they allowing themselves to be lulled into a full sense of optimism?
I think Al Watan has got it absolutely on the money. And I think the demonstrators have got it on the money too, because they're not going home. I mean, they're not as big as they were. But I think they've scored a big victory. No, definitely, they got the elections delayed. They blocked Bouteflika's candidacy. And now they've got le pouvoir searching around for a sort of a stopgap candidate, a compromise candidate. But people know this. They can see through this stuff. So I think in the absence of a credible candidate, you're going to see some very new developments in the politics. I mean, I don't think the struggle is over by any means. I think people are going to stay on the streets. And they've proved for once and all it's possible to organize peacefully, to demonstrate in your hundreds and thousands and get political change. I think that's a tremendously important message, not just for Algeria and North Africa, but for the whole continent, indeed for the whole world. So it's at a time when everyone's getting very skeptical about democracy and constitutional routes to power and political change. I think the Algerians have come from this place and are proving it can be done. But I agree. I mean, it's by all means, it's the job is nowhere, not even half done. I mean, there's a lot more to come.
Is there an interesting parallel with Zimbabwe? You know, both are settler colonies. Both have a liberation regime which curdled with corruption. Both have faced serious attempts to dislodge them. Is there an analogy to Zimbabwe, and how far along the curve are the anti-regime elements in Zimbabwe?
Yeah, I think I think so. Of course, yeah, Algeria had this horrendous war in the 1990s after the Islamist Fees Party won open parliamentary elections in 91 and the military intervened. That's what sparked that. And that became that horrendous war with 200,000 people getting killed. That sort of served as a kind of cautionary tale for Algerian activists. In a way, what happened in Zimbabwe was much less, but no less tragic, much less in terms of numbers. There was the election in 2008, and the violence that the state meted out on the opposition certainly over 200 people killed, many maimed, and it was a pretty horrendous time. So I think they do track each other. I guess what the problem now in Zimbabwe is the economy is in absolute meltdown. I saw a really harrowing video this morning from the main hospital in Harare with a doctor in total despair. The lack of electricity, the lack of drugs, the lack of surgical instruments. She could not save the lives of children